As a lover of books, I really, really appreciate JLF. I love JLF. I come here every year. I attend sessions.
The people, the vibrancy, the amount of different topics, the panels, the hospitality, the culture, everything. It's wonderful.
I feel a deep sense of satisfaction that the literary scene in India is so vibrant and so alive. We've had writers from 15 Indian languages and almost 30 international languages.
Jaipur Literary Festival is there so many brilliant things on at the same time that you can't choose what to go to. It's really fantastic. It's wonderful to be here.
People be able to just listen to the writers for what they're having to say and enjoy the festival.
It's a privilege to be here, and the diversity of the programming is great, and the standard of the debate is very high as well. We learn so much when we're on the panel, and we learn so much when we're in the audience too.
Absolutely live from Diggy Palace.
I'm coming from 2007, when I was 7 years, from that year I'm coming, and I love so much, I meet so many authors, and it's like amazing.
It's really good to see the Jaipur youth, you know, getting so excited for this.
Passion of the people on stage. They're inspiring all these people. Such an incredible turnout to listen to all these people.
I've come to this bookstore 4 or 5 times, and every time I walk away with another book.
I've been to festivals all over the world, but I've never been to a festival that is anything like it. It is more enjoyable, more exciting, more vibrant, and it's free.
It crosses boundaries and limits and heritages. And that is brilliant.
All the speakers, they made us so much clear and love for the literature more and more. And they updated us that what's the new upcoming. And I'm thankful to JLF.
And it's nice to see so many, especially young people, interested in literature. It's amazing to see how many of them just keep coming back and coming back and sitting through all the panels and taking down notes.
It's a very great thing to have this festival in Jaipur. So we come here. We get a lot of knowledge, we can cluster the knowledge here.
Around 6 sessions, and whether it's Samvad or whether in Charbagh, everything together, isn't it wonderful for each and every one to experience this? Especially the ones in school, to know that there is value in books and not always on the mobiles, sticking to it every time. Well, it is indeed the Kumbh of literature.
Very pleased with particularly how the performance poetry has gone. It's something I think we've been weak on in the past. We've had some very good sessions from the Arab world, some remarkable sessions from West Africa.
And what I love about JLF is that it makes space for poetry. Poetry is not often given as much time and love as it gets here.
Our duty, as we see it, is to bring the world to India and India to the world.
The only way to transform societies is through knowledge and through culture. And if you're able to make knowledge accessible to those who don't otherwise have access to it, that in itself is a great way of bringing about change.
Maro hello, hello, Jimaro hello, Tsuno Jirama B. Aramda Jimara Jigija.
Thank you. A celebration of literature in the tranquil Suneva Fushi, Maldives, reinforcing South Asia's unique literary heritage. Spread luxuriously over 2 weekends, it brings globally celebrated authors for panels, workshops, music, poetry readings, and film screenings. Focusing on diverse themes such as travel, fiction, food, art, wellness, climate change, the environment, and more. JLF Suneva Fushi.
As a lover of books, I really, really appreciate JLF. I love JLF.
Welcome to a little bit of London that is forever Jaipur.
Dear friends and lovers of literature, here we are again with JLF at the British Library 2021.
It's a particular pleasure for me to come back to the British Library, which has been my office in London for many years, where my books have all been written and researched, and it's very nice to see this end of my life, sort of double back on it.
Our amazing writers, today more than any time, because of the way the digital age has taken over, we need you to be able to make sense of the past, divine the future, and perhaps set in context what we're going through at this very point of time.
Do you feel that Britain and India can best intersect culturally?
Well, we've been intersecting for a long time. It's not that we will have to intersect. If you look at our cultural and historical relations, we go back a long way.
That may be nations or cultures or religions or sexualities, class, culture, gender, race, all those things, but that distance is somehow reduced or bridged, because we're connecting at a very basic human level.
I believe in the ability to convey meaning by the written word is our superpower.
Welcome back for another exciting session of the 2021 edition of JLF London here at the British Library, the virtual festival. This session is Sanskrit, Astronomy and Mathematics. Kim Plofker in conversation with William Dalrymple. Mathematician Kim Plofker is a leading scholar of the history of maths and astronomy in Sanskrit and other Indian languages. In conversation with William Dalrymple, she will chronicle the development of mathematical techniques and texts in South Asia from antiquity to the early modern period. You can watch all our sessions on our website, london.jlflitfest.org, and they'll also be available to view on our Facebook page and YouTube channel. We'd love to know your views on the session. Feel free to drop your questions in anytime and observations, all in the comments section. Ladies and gentlemen, Sanskrit, Astronomy and Mathematics. Kim Plofker in conversation with William Dalrymple.
Well, welcome to another session of the Jaipur Literature Festival at the British Library, what I like to think of as Jaipur on Thames. And it's my huge pleasure to meet and introduce to you the great Kim Plofker, who is someone who has made clear the incredible subtlety and intricacies of Sanskrit mathematics. Every Indian knows about Aryabhatta and Brahmagupta, knows how India invented the zero and how the numbers known in the Western world as Arabic numbers, in fact, have their origins within India. In the West, however, people remain largely ignorant about this major contribution of India to world civilization. And the fact that we all use Indian numbers today is something that I think very few people outside India really know. This is why Kim Plofker's work is so incredibly important. Her wonderful book, In Mathematics in India, which I read last year, makes clear, even to a non-mathematician layman such as myself, the extraordinary history of how Indian thinkers, or to use the words of Aryabhatta, dive deep into the ocean of astronomical theories, true and false, and rescued the sunken jewels of knowledge by means of the boat of intellect. Kim, we would love you to give a brief introduction to your work and then we can chat. Over to you.
Thank you. And thank you very much for that kind introduction. It's really great to be here. And I almost begrudge the time I'm spending talking about things I know somewhat about, because I'd like to, you know, just learn more about everything that's going on at the Jaipur Literature Festival. I regret that even when I lived in Jaipur, I hadn't managed to attend this, but I'm really excited to see the Jaipur on Thames version. And to get into this subject a bit, I think you really put your finger on the problem that all our historians of science and Indian science in particular are struggling with, that we've had a very a Eurocentric traditional perspective of what the mathematical sciences were like. I mean, here is, if you look at the little diagram here, mostly what people think of as the picture you get out of standard history of mathematics texts. It starts, it's focused on Greek mathematics. There's a few significant inputs from Babylonian and Egyptian earlier period mathematics, especially using the base 60 numbers that we now still use to tell time. And then there's this idea that Greek mathematics goes off a little bit into Indian and Chinese. Something is happening over there in the East, but we don't pay much attention. And then you get mostly Greek and some Indian mathematics coming into the Islamic world. And of course, where historians of mathematics really brisk up and start paying attention in their books is when you get into the Renaissance, the rediscovery of Greek geometry, and the development of European versions of algebra, and consequently developments in geometry, calculus, just the whole early modern mathematical explosion. Whereas, what those of us who are working in the field really see a lot more of in terms of the medieval world as it actually was, not looking at it with the hindsight of, oh, well, what do we think now turned out to be important? We would have, the ancient Mediterranean culture influence on Greek Hellenistic math, which is certainly very important, but the impact of Indian and indirectly Chinese mathematics on Islamic mathematics is really at least as important as the Greek influence. Hellenistic geometry, the Euclidean format, having these lettered diagrams and rigorous proofs and QED and your axioms and so forth, that's an important part of mathematics, but it's really at most about half of the mathematics that's happening. And then, of course, at this point, only a small amount of that is really filtering into Western Europe, into the Latin texts. In particular, as you say, everybody knows that there are the so-called Arabic numerals, but what medieval Arabs and other Islamic mathematicians knew at the time very clearly was that these were developed in India. There may have been some influence in, before the Common Era or the early Common Era from the Chinese counting board numerals, decimal place value numerals laid out with rods on a counting board. But the idea of having decimal place value numerals as single glyphs is something that seems, incontrovertibly to have emerged in India, though we don't know exactly when. The first few centuries of the Common Era, maybe. I mean, what we see in the textual evidence, and the textual evidence we have is mostly what we can get off rock inscriptions from this period, is notes of these tally style numerals in the period of Ashoka, late first millennium BCE. And then you get some, single glyph and non-place value numerals showing up in around that time a little later. But it's clearly not a place value system yet, because as you can see in the table here, you've got different glyphs for 10 and for 20 and for 40 and so on, than the symbols for 1 and 2 and 4. So it is an additive non-place value system, as it's called. And then what we start to see in the first millennium are inscriptions showing how these numerals evolved into place value use. Unfortunately, as is often the case with epigraphic, you know, carved inscriptions, the events we're seeing are not really cutting edge, no pun intended. Epigraphic numbers and, you know, all forms of paleography tend to be a bit conservative. I mean, if you look at a carved statue or the inscription on the statue plinth made today, you might get the impression that we were still using Roman numerals. You know, when you are carving an inscription, you tend to use old-fashioned forms. But even so, we have, by the middle of the first millennium of this era, very definite and recognizable numbers that are place value, and including the zero here in the picture of the Gwalior temple inscription from the middle of the millennium is a very recognizable 270, along with this nice proto-Nagari script there. And this is something that was taken over wholesale with the calculation techniques, with the decimal place value arithmetic, into Islamic mathematics, and a little penetration into Eastern Christian sciences as well. And this so-called Hisab al-Hind, the Indian calculation, used adapted forms, numerous different slightly modified forms of these Indian numerals. And of course, the person who is most associated with this is the famous scientist Al-Khwarizmi in the 9th century, who gave his name to the modern word algorithm, and from whom we also know the word algebra, because that's an Arabic work as well. Here you can see an Arabic manuscript of a work from the 10th century, where he's talking about the Indian calculation, and there's some fairly recognizable numerals, a 1 and a 9 and a 7 there, again, modified forms, and they came to Europe and they got modified more, but definitely the same system. And here is the Eastern Christian allusion to that from the 7th century that I mentioned, our Bishop Severus Sebokht, with an artist's representation of him there, speaking of the science of the Hindus, their computation done by means of 9 signs, which seems to suggest the absence of a zero, but it could just mean that Sebokht didn't think of zero as being a sign for a number. It took the Western world quite a bit of time to, wrap their heads around that. But, if those who believe, because they speak Greek, that they have reached the limits of science should know these things, they'd be convinced that there are also others who know something, words to live by even today. And in the 12th century, we have another scholar familiar with work outside of the Latin context, Abraham Ibn Ezra of Spain, and saying that they drew figures for the 9 numerals, and they put a little circle like that as a sign, to indicate the absence of a digit. This is something that really begins to become gain currency in more ways than one in the Western world in the early 13th century, with the arithmetic of Leonardo of Pisa or Fibonacci, the same Fibonacci sequence guy. And he speaks of these nine Indian figures. And at this point, as you can see from the copy of this manuscript, the forms we see are getting to be quite familiar as prototypes of the modern so-called Arabic numerals of today. So these nine figures and the little circular sign, which sifr, zephyr, our modern word cipher, any number whatsoever is written. And this is, you know, really a marvelous accomplishment in so many ways that you can, as opposed to the limitations, even in the Hellenistic period, where a great deal of really creative mathematics was going on, you couldn't write a number that you couldn't name. You had the Hellenistic, the Greek word myriad for 10,000, and that was, you know, modifications of that or multiples of that was really as far as you could go if you wanted a named numeral. And if you wanted to write it out in figures, of course, you had to invent a new notation system or a modification of that. But the decimal place value numeration is, you know, infinitely extensible in that way. You can write even numbers that you don't have a name for, up in the gazillions. So as so often happens, you know, even nowadays, maybe especially nowadays with the growth of the internet, as soon as people learn about something and you know, something that comes from somewhere else or something unfamiliar, they start making up stories or, you know, misremembering stories or modifying the stories about where it came from and, you know, what it's for. So you have Abraham Ibn Ezra's legend there, where he attributes this discovery to an individual Indian who came to the king in Baghdad, and he taught the Arabs the basis of number. Now, you know, we do have records or you know, evidence of Indian scholars and Indian texts in Sanskrit having come to Baghdad in the middle of the 8th century, when the city was founded in 762. Nice little woodcut of that there. But it was definitely not the original source or the only source of Islamic awareness of the Indian numbers. And then, you know, people are just really, you know, letting their imaginations run riot here, as we can see in this quote from a 14th century English text about the craft of numbering, which is called algorithmus, which is very true. That was the standard Latin name for the work. And in which we use 10 signs of Ind, the 10 Indian signs. But he says that they were found first in India by a king of that country who was called Algor. Okay, you know, please don't spread this rumor because, you know, it wasn't true back in the 14th century and it isn't true now. But it gives you the sense of how people's names and, you know, just little scraps of information get attached to you know, other facts, and these urban legends or, you know, interurban, international legends grow up. And then we get in this process of kind of cultural forgetting, we have Renaissance and later European sources just assuming that the ultimate source of the number, you know, since the immediate source of these numbers is the Arabs, then, you know, that's the ultimate source as well. here's John of Sacrobosco in the 13th century. You know, again, we've got our friend Algus or Algorismus as opposed to Al-Khwarizmi. And he has this ingenious idea that you do your numeration, you know, your place value, most significant digits are towards the left because the Arabs write from right to left. So you start out, you know, going, oh, you're with your ones and then leftwards for your tens and so on. This is not how it happened. From the very beginning in Indian decimal place value numerals, they wrote them just as we do. And Islamic mathematicians kept that system. You know, that hasn't changed. There was a little fluctuation in medieval Europe when people were figuring it out. But, you know, really, it's worked that way. So I don't know if you would like to, you know, move on to another topic here or just switch into our conversation. Or
Kim, what I'm looking to know is some of the main characters, because Ari Butter, again, is someone who, you know, so much is attributed to, and yet not everything that he is attributed to him actually seems to cover him. For example, zero does not seem to be in one of his accomplishments. Will you talk a little about him and then about Brahmagupta?
Brahmagupta,
particularly being a Rajasthani festival. We've used the Brahmagupta from Mount Abu.
I mean, I think we really have to start with the awareness that, I mean, certainly to the extent that any Indian mathematicians are common knowledge or familiar figures in mainstream history of science outside of India, it would be, you know, probably the big four. That's Aryabhatta and Brahmagupta and Bhaskara II, Bhaskaracharya, and perhaps a, you know, a shifting fourth one. Could be the first Bhaskara, could be
Paramahila,
could be Madhava, definitely. But the thing to remember is that Aryabhatta, who says he was born in the year that would correspond to our 476 of the Common Era, and wrote his famous treatise Aryabhatiya, you know, around 500, he is not the originator of any of this material. He definitely has the concept of zero and place value numbers of the manipulation of them in decimal place value arithmetic and a great deal of sophisticated algebra, trigonometry, geometry, all sorts of material. But we are sort of, his is the earliest major treatise in mathematical sciences that we have from this period in Sanskrit. And it's obviously, you know, dumping us into the middle of the subject. So much was known before Aryabhatta's time, excuse me. And he continued developing it.
And he's drawing on Greek, Egyptian, and Babylonian mathematics, is he?
Well, we, you know, there has been, you know, a sort of, we've been in a kind of stasis about understanding possible relations between Babylonian and ancient Indian mathematics. Certainly, we have the Achaemenid Empire of around the middle of the first millennium BCE, and that is a, you know, a geographical and political connection between northwest India and
the Achaemenid being the Persians. Exactly.
And yeah. You know, so we know that you know, they were familiar with some aspects of Babylonian mathematics, and we do start to see in mid to late first millennium Sanskrit texts, there are uses of the sexagesimal base 60 number divisions, and there are other related aspects of astronomy, for techniques for figuring out the length of daylight and so on. But none of this, as has been pointed out, is necessarily is incapable of having been developed independently. So we don't have any direct textual links between the Babylonian and the Indian material at that time. When it comes to the Hellenistic,
he talks about a spherical Earth. He comes very close to pi, doesn't he? I mean, he's doing it all in a poetic form. It's very very concise. Yes.
And Aryabhatta has a very good value for pi. Definitely by this time for scientists, popular cosmology, would have been and always remained somewhat different. But for scientists, the idea of a spherical use Earth and a spherical universe is absolutely standard. I mean, obviously, there are so many things you can explain that way that they're very difficult to explain otherwise. And
Aryabhatta is probably somewhere in Paliputra in Bihar and the early Gupta period. Is that the sort of time we're talking?
I mean, so we believe, yes, in the, definitely we know time, and as I said, pretty much smack in the middle of the first millennium CE, and, but he's building on a lot of material about these spherical models, spherical coordinates that seems to have come in from Hellenistic sources with the Indo-Greek and Indo-Scythian kingdoms, the Shaka. And as we see just throughout the development of mathematics, you have some material coming in from another source, but the people who are working with it in the existing tradition just make it their own. They integrate it into what they're doing and the ways that they think about it. So interestingly, it seems that the real attraction in Hellenistic mathematical sciences was, as it was so many other places and periods, astrology. This idea of having this system where you know what these irregularly moving planets are going to do, and that this has an whole system of correlations with things that happen on Earth. There have always been people who were skeptical about it, but there have always been, not unreasonably, people who say, wow, I can predict the future, give me that. So that's kind of how the Greek spherical astronomy and related concepts in trigonometry and so forth find their way into the work of authors such as Aryabhatta. But Aryabhatta and the mathematicians that come after him in the Indian tradition are just developing this so much in their own directions and coming up with these magnificent results and discoveries. And as you say, doing this all in Sanskrit verse at the same time. It's wonderful.
Let's move on to Brahmagupta, our fellow Rajasthani, sitting in Mount Abu and being quite critical of Aryabhatta's work.
Yes, I mean, Brahmagupta is the, he's left us the first surviving treatise in the form called Siddhanta that has the format that then becomes, really standard in Siddhanta material. Well, Brahmagupta and his immediate contemporary, Bhaskara the First. So Brahmagupta is writing this
598, is it? And just 600, that sort of period.
That's right, yes. Yeah, so, probably born in 598, and the date of the Brahmas Buddha Siddhanta is 628. And as I say, his contemporary Bhaskara is writing about 627. So, Brahmagupta has this beautifully organized and massive treatise, including separate chapters on arithmetic and algebra. So he's the first source of that we have in Sanskrit of specifically articulated sign rules for, you know, if you multiply a positive by a negative, you get a negative, and so on and so forth. And
he really understands all the properties of zero for the first time, doesn't he?
Yes,
he really lays out.
And I mean, I wouldn't say for the first time. I mean, he and Aryabhatta definitely have this rivalry between going on between their schools, based largely on the parameters that they've chosen to use for their astronomical systems. But I think, you know, there would have been nothing that Brahmagupta knew about the basics of arithmetic and algebra that Aryabhatta himself didn't already know. This is a mature tradition. I mean, one of the things we really struggle with is that because a certain author is the first attested source for a particular concept, we assume that this author invented that concept, but not true. Let's be fair to the unknown Indian astronomers and mathematicians of 300 and 400 and so on, who were working with this. They developed it. We don't know their names or their works, but we know they were there.
And talking of unknowns, this is one of his great contributions, Brahmagupta. He talks the difference between manifest computation and unmanifest computation, and where we would use X and Y, he uses colors.
Yes, and this is mentioned in Aryabhatta as well. He mentioned using beads and so on. And this, again, you know, this clearly indicates a stage in a mature tradition that has been developed for centuries. And it could represent a sort of graphical form of laying out of equations where you have different variables represented by beads of different colors. And, you know, coefficients are shown by how many you've got a number written next to them, you know, because you do have the writing out on a dustboard or just on the ground. The first known form of equation notation. You have two sides or wings of an equation that have unknown and known quantities in them, and you are balancing them. It's the rules of algebra that let you find what your unknown quantities are. So yeah, by the time of Aryabhatta, and certainly by Brahmagupta, you know, this is understood to a very sophisticated extent.
One thing, Kim, I'd love to end on before we go to questions, is there's been a controversy lately, which you played a part in, on the dating of the Bakshali manuscript, which now sits in the Bodleian, found near Peshawar, yes. and which may or may not contain the first zero, depending on when you date it. Now, what's your stand on this? Because there's been a lot of huffing and puffing from rival groups of mathematicians lately.
I know. I regret that this has become controversial, because I think in terms of what we all know, I don't think there's that much dispute about the facts. I mean, there definitely is the Bakshali manuscript, which is this wonderful document on birch bark that was found in the late 19th century near Peshawar. And it clearly dates back to at least the 12th century in terms of when it was written, you know, very possibly the 7th, which in terms of a South Asian manuscript makes it incredibly antique. There are very few written documents that aren't on stone or copper that have survived, you know, South Asian climate, for that length of time. And, so it is definitely, medieval in its composition, and it definitely contains mathematical knowledge and algorithms, rules and sample problems that go back all the way to this early first millennium. The development, again, this is a quite sophisticated form of arithmetic problem solving. But the question is, do we take the radiocarbon dating results about the physical age of some of the organic material in the manuscript as being indicative of when the manuscript was written. And that, I think, is a tough call, especially, I mean, I think where I would take my stand on this is simply that there's more uncertainty than, you know, just a very straightforward or naive inference from the dating information would suggest. Because as
Kim, Professor Hayashi, would you think that it's before or after that inscription in Gwalior that you showed us in one of your first slides? I've seen both in the last year. I went down to Gwalior and then got the Bakshali manuscript out of the Bodleian, and I was unable to make up my mind which were first. Which would you date? You had to put your money on it.
That's a very tough call, and I would, just to complicate things a bit, I would say that of course there are decimal place value numerals in Southeast Asia that are influenced by the Indian tradition, because definitely it was part of the Sanskrit sphere, intellectual sphere at that time, that are earlier than the Gwalior. So, as I say, all of these sources clearly reflect a very sophisticated handling of decimal place value numerals, certainly by the by the start of the second quarter of the first millennium. But
second quarter, so that's after 500.
Yeah, I would say, I mean, we certainly see, 200 to 300, if I had to guess. And again, I can only guess in the absence of, really securely dated texts. But also, sadly, we just can't treat the surviving texts and even the surviving paleographic and epigraphic data in stone inscriptions and the Bakshali manuscript as a guarantee of the chronology, because there's so much more that was out there that is now sadly lost.
We've got lots and lots of questions, Kim. Can we do quick fire answers just so that the
please, I'll do my best. Yeah.
Who are watching. You've got more questions than we've had for many sessions here. So Sudadeep asks, engrossing session, he says, my question is, what are the primary sources that prove Babylonian influence on ancient Indian mathematics? This, of course, is something regarded as coming out of India and not needing any external influence. How would you prove that there is influence?
That's an easy one to answer. There aren't any. There is no proof of Babylonian influence on early Indian mathematics. It is, it is something that is part of a historiographic hypothesis, which is what historians do, especially in a tradition where there is, a lot, we are missing a lot of the ancient sources that were there. It is something that has been inferred from similarities between these texts, but if anybody says that connection is proved, they are not right.
So the next question from Tim Fraser leads on from that. He says, you've written about how mathematics is an amalgamation of work across different civilizations. Do you think mathematics in turn has impacted on culture and civilizations?
Oh, absolutely. Yes. I mean, an example is, look at the way that mathematics is considered in the Western world and the heirs of the Greek tradition as kind of this almost divine type of exactitude in knowledge, the fundamental influence, the sort of thing that we can know with, in a much more sure way than we can know other things. That's not necessarily a cultural universal. The scholar Johannes Bronckhorst has made the very, others have made the very interesting observation that the canonical science in the Sanskrit tradition might be considered to be grammar rather than mathematics, because the Indians kind of invented the systematic study of,
and so on.
Yeah, yeah. So, you know, that's really about how can you know anything until you understand the linguistic, you know, phenomena that involve saying something. How can you know what you mean until you know what you understand what you say? So that, I'd say, is an example of mathematics impacting culture, you know, because it's carving its own place in the cultural understanding.
One last quickie, if you would. Dev Vijayan says, who is an obscure Indian mathematician of pre-modern times we should know more about? If you had one guy you'd take who we should all know more about, who would you take?
Oh my gosh, one, that's terrible. Okay, my favorite, one of my personal favorite people is Parameshwara of Kerala. He was a student of the great Madhava, the guy whose name is now attached to the Madhava Leibniz, Madhava Gregory, Madhava Newton power series. And, you know, Parameshwara, you know, he's not unknown, but I think he wrote so much interesting stuff. He has left records of astronomical observations, which are quite rare. And he's just such an interesting guy. I wish information, you know, more things were generally known about him. But my goodness, you know, that
list would go on and on.
Parameshwara. Yeah. Right. Parameshwara is from the 15th century in Kerala.
So very late in the story by Indian standards.
Sorry?
Very late in the story by Indian standards.
I suppose. I mean, the Indian story does go up right through the 19th and 20th century in terms of people doing that mathematics. But yes, he is coming in this, what you might call the early modern or post-Bhaskara II period.
Kim, thank you so much. I can't tell you how many questions, how much interest this has provoked. I'm sure many people would be now heading to the library and getting some copies of your book.
I'm so pleased, and it was great to talk to you. Thank you so much.
Thank you. I hope you'll come to Jaipur proper one day.
Hear, hear. Yes, love to.